the dais, respected dignitaries, dear students and research scholars over here. It's indeed a great pleasure for me to talk to you on a subject perhaps a police officer will not dare to talk to. I'm not an economics person, I'm a chemistry person, I'm a management person and a social scientist with a PhD in conflict management. But my only qualification for economics is I taught my daughter economics in +2 and she was state rank in Delhi. That's the only qualification on which I know economics, on which I want to speak on it. I heard a respected professor talking about the economic development, eradication of poverty, its values and how we are going to satisfy the global requirements. I may be treading on some of this area, but I would like to maybe disagree also in some of what he has spoken to, even though I am not an economist. But I have done my homework on all these aspects, so I would like to give a completely different picture on the entire issue of economic development, poverty alleviation, and our commitments to the international community. Economic development as a concept has failed to eliminate poverty, especially in third world countries, more so in India. There are two reasons for this. I'm not an economist. Poverty is the gift of colonial powers given to third world. Second is the slow evolution of the concept of economic development from industry orientation to human development orientation, which has spewed poverty along with the universe. And how this has evolved. After First and Second World War, Industrial Revolution came. So your Adam Smith concept of supply, demand, profit, industrialization all took over. And economic development was spoken in terms of production and employment created by the production, neglecting the agricultural production and the employment created by the agriculture. This happened in 1950 to 60. And this suited the entire developed world because they had a huge corpus of looted money from the third world in the form of large amount of natural resources they looted and let us have high and dry. And they started thriving a lot. And then we got independence, we also started following the same pattern of industrialization and creating job opportunities, neglecting agriculture and agriculture. But however, somewhere in 1970, Dudley Shears, you would have heard Professor Dudley Shears, he tried to change the concept of economic by bringing in the aspect of poverty alleviation, unemployment, and inequality. These are the three areas which he focuses. He says that economic development should bring change. That's how we should measure economic development. So the change came in. And the world was completely ignorant. By 1980, there were 300 million poor around the world. This made United Nations to wake up and define what economic development is in 1990. They define is what they have defined, I will quote. The challenge of economic development is to improve the quality of life, better education, higher standard of health, nutrition, lesser poverty, cleaner environment, more equality of opportunity, greater individual freedom and richer cultural life. This was defined in 1990. This is how economic development has been measured. This was further fine-tuned by Professor Gavlet. You would have heard about Professor Gavlet, who clearly told sustenance, self-esteem and freedom is the core of economic development. That's how from industry we came to human development. But what happened in this? What happened during this period? The outcome of this economic development was uneven distribution of wealth. 90% of the wealth is 10% of the population and 90% of that 90% is 1% of the population. 1% are billionaires and 21% are billionaires around the world. Aggressive corporatization of all aspects of basic needs. Example is the water bottle in front of us. This has to be provided free by the government, but we are buying it. Aggressive corporatization of basic need. We are paying tax for all these things, but we are buying things back from the government. This is what happened over a period of time. The money power and corporate power is dictating how to run the democracy. Money power and corporate power is dictating how to run democracy, not only in India and US, everywhere in the country. Democracy is in danger. The poor are becoming poorer, they are becoming inefficient, and they are getting into a cycle of misery. But nobody is bothered about it. National resources are being plundered, left, right, center. If you see the billionaires of this world, they are all plunderers of natural resources. Even the billionaires are plunderers of natural resources. These are the resources for the public. Why this 1% and 21% to enjoy all this? This is where you need to read and go, look, enough of this, let us now have a proper perspective. Then came the 2000 Universal Millennium Declaration, what as Professor Rightly pointed out. And that also didn't work. We are in 2015. That Millennium Declaration was done in 2015. To be implemented by 2015. Nothing happened, as the professor has already told. So we came out with another concept, because by the time global warming, everything became an issue, and sustaining natural resources became a very, very important issue. So sustainable development goals are propounded by 193 countries together. That is where we stand. Now, let us have a where does India stand in this economic development, as well as how we are going to comply with the international commitments? We were the richest country in the 18th century. 19th to 20th century, we were looted high and dry by the British. Shashi Tharoor's 5 minutes debate in BBC is a typical example of how India was treated. After independence, what happened was our constitution guided us. Socialist, secular, democratic republic was the preamble which we followed. We achieved green revolution, we achieved white revolution, we achieved blue revolution. All these things were achieved because we were very humane in our development approach. Yes, we had problems, but we were completely self-reliant. We were neither dependent on US nor on Russia. We were on our own. We have come a long way in the economic development. Then came the Depression in 1990 when we got into industrialization. But after 1990 when India got into industrialization, there was no stop for India. Today we are 10th in the world as highly industrialized country in the world. This is the way we have economically developed over a period of time. There are positive narratives on our development, there are negative narratives on our development. I would like to first highlight the positive narrative. 11% of the gold reserve of the world is in Indian, with Indian wives, not with India, with Indian wives, which is equal to the gold reserve of USA, Switzerland, and IMF. Third largest economy in the world, which is assured growth of GDP of 7% till 2030. No country can do this. Shit, we have that capability. Largest pool of English speaking population, and largest pool of engineers and scientists. Second largest farm input, second largest silk input, second largest exporter of engineering products, 26% of GDP is contributed by industrial progress, and 57% of the GDP is by the services. We have the world's fourth largest army, both in terms of strength as well as deadliness of the army. And we have the sixth largest coal and iron reserve. These are the positive narratives. But we will all feel proud about this. But when I talk about negative narratives, we have to hang our head in shame and come out with the negative narratives. We have miserably failed in elevation of output. We are 117 in HDA index in 2017. We have slipped down by 27%. We may talk, we are going to be superpower. It's all Bhankam, just talking like that, talking off the cuff, without understanding the ground reality, without understanding what is happening in the country. We are in 100 out of 117 in the global hunger index. 270 million are poor. One in five Indians are poor. And one third of the world poor is in India. 145 million people live in slums. 200 million people are food insecure. They seem to feel hungry in this country. 217 million people endure multi-dimensional poverty stress. 43% of the population suffers malnutrition. And 74% are micronutrients starved. 50% of the urban population and 80% of the rural population don't have basic facilities. Life expectancy is less than Pakistan, with highest child mortality in Asia. Adult literacy far more less than Sri Lanka. 55% of our class 4 students do not understand who's in it. Value addition of agriculture was 44% in 1965, now it is 16%. So we have not even planned for climate change. These are the negative narratives of our country's economic development. So why this has happened? I will give some brief statistics since time is a constraint. Agricultural contribution is 17% of the GDP, employing 49% of the workforce. Youngsters are there, please think over this and you can write a paper on this. Industry contribution is 26% of the GDP, employing 22% of the workforce. Service contribution is 57% of the GDP, employing 27% of the workforce. Look at the gradual slide in the employment of workforce, which indicates that these workforce are better paid than in the agricultural sector. So our concentration on development of agriculture, industry and services are completely warped. 49% are still under poverty level. Unless and otherwise we correct this and have an equitable development in all the fronts, I am afraid that India will not develop as a superpower at all. You youngsters need to work on this and highlight it to the government and grow up. The second aspect which is pulling us down is corruption. Corruption is becoming part of Indian DNA. I can tell it with confidence having worked in the anti-corruption agency for 36 years. This is sapping the country of its required amount for development as per the Millennium Goal. I will highlight that also. We lose 70% of our GDP to corruption. 70% of the GDP is a phenomenal amount. If you calculate from the, actually the 70% started after liberalization. If you start 70% GDP loss from 1990, and had you plugged it to 1990 itself, our country would have been better than the United States of America. But we were good. Because of vested interest corruption, we are completely people with self-interest, not bothered about others, completely hypocritical about everything, we are not bothered to solve the problem. A solution will not come. So unless and otherwise these structural corrections are made and corruption is erased, whatever be our commitment to the international community, I need some more time to finish it up. I am aware of the time. But the youngsters are there, I just want to highlight that, because I have prepared something for the benefit of the youngsters, not for anyone. So this is how we need to shape. How do we shape it? How are we going to shape it? I have projected the problem and I have a solution also. I'll highlight and tell you how we can work out. You are the future generation. We have lived our life. And you have to face the condition. And you need to work on and work on. Now what is our Millennium Development
goals?
There are eight goals with 12 targets. And I have gone through the Government of India's report on compliance of MDG 2000, placed in the parliament. It's a complete bluff of what we have done. I'll highlight this. First is on hunger and poverty. We have told that we have achieved the target by reducing the poverty by 50%. How? We calculated BPL population, but telling 33 rupees is enough. When the UN is selling it, is either $1 or $2. So what we do is we say below $1 is the population, so we are improved. We are cheating ourselves. Somewhere we'll have to say what is the amount of population. where is 33 rupees, where is 60 rupees? And this 32 rupees is only for food. No shelter and no medical care. Are these BPL people animals? How are we calculating? How you economics are dealing with this? Why you people are not arguing on this and tell that BPL has to be a different yardstick? Unless and otherwise we know the depth of our poverty, how are we going to find a solution? We are not doing that. By telling that 33, Tendulkar report says 33, Rangarajan says 55, no, that is wrong, that is right. Because we want to show that we have reduced poverty. This is cheating ourselves, hostage approach. This is where we are cheating ourselves while committing before the international community. Again, by giving a wrong report to the international community, we are not cheating the international community, we are cheating ourselves. Then comes the hunger. We have not succeeded in controlling hunger, but we are in the process of getting achieving. This is what is mentioned in the government report. 16% of your food we are producing in our house is wasted. 20% of the agricultural produce which is produced by the country is wasted. Whereas 20% of the population sleeps without food. Why economists are not talking about this? Why are we not highlighting it? Why it is not discussed in the parliament? Because we are just not concerned about the poor in this country. We are concerned only on capitalism and big fellows, all political parties owning private aircrafts and running around for the election. We can't make anything more than that. So this is where we are cheating ourselves. Then come to gender equality and empowerment. The report given is that we have given 33% reservation for women in panchayat. So we have achieved equality for gender. Absolute nonsense and bunkum which we have shown in our commitment before the international community. We are not talking about 50% reservation even in the parliament or in this thing, anywhere else, but we say we have achieved equality. This is how we have worked before the international community. Then comes HIV/AIDS, and which Professor has also pointed out, we were supposed to reduce the amount by 50%. We have achieved it. That's what we have mentioned in our report. But the Indian Medical Association has said that our statistics are not believable. When we don't have statistics which is believable, how are we told we have achieved these targets? Again, we are cheating ourselves by telling before the international community we have achieved it. Environment and sustainability, there are three points. One is to reverse loss of environmental resources. We have shown under progress without sending a single pipe. Private safe drinking water and sanitation, we have told to the international community we have achieved it. Whereas 50 and 80% don't have this. But before international committee, we are told we have achieved this. Then comes global participation in development, another Millennium Development Goal. Here, what we have done is that we have told that our mobile reach has improved, so we have achieved it. Complete cheating ourselves. We are extremely good at cheating ourselves. Now, MDG has gone to 2015, and SDG has come to 2030. SDG is nothing but superimposition of MDG on SDG. So when we are building up our commitment to the international community on the back of the lies, how are we going to implement the SDGs of 2030? Here also I have some solution. There is an institute in Delhi which has worked out the financial requirement for this SDG commitments. And they have calculated for next 9 years, they need 52 lakh crore of rupees to bring all the changes in. I will give you the reason and how we can go about it. Now, even in this millennium, sustainable development goal, there are 17 goals, but we have chosen only 12. We have left that sea and the environment separate because we are not doing anything, but we are committed to the world that we will be complying with the legal goals. And this 12 we can divide into 3. Improving the quality of life of the poor. Improving the overall quality of life and improving the overall quality of life and environment. I can divide this 16 roads into 3 categories. In the first category, we have just 6 roads. In the second category, we have just 3 goals. In the last one, we have just 6 goals. I will quickly go through that. Our commitment to improve the quality of life of the poor. The first one is poverty and hunger. Agriculture is delivering at 50% efficiency in our country. Best solution is if you improve the efficiency of output to at least 80%, 100% is the world standard. We increase our agriculture production by another 50%. Hunger and poverty will disappear. But none of these stupid politicians talk about this in this country. And nobody, right? Economics are also not talking about it. Because economic development has been hijacked by capitalism. We are not aware of it, but it is a fact. Why are we not doing this? Now, as per the calculation of the institute, 1.85 lakh crores per year for coming another 10 years to achieve complete zero poverty in hunger. This is nothing. This 1.9 lakh crore is nothing for India, right? The size of Indian economy. We can achieve, but nobody is bothered. Then comes environment health, ensuring health and providing well-being for health infrastructure. It's in shambles. Poor man cannot get his what he deserves. We have corporatized the health infrastructure and made it unaffordable even to the middle class. My daughter is working in a corporate hospital. She comes and tells me stories. I'm shocked to hear about to what extent they can go. A man is brain dead. They are fixing titanium on his broken leg. They are putting a pacemaker for his heart, and she shows, Papa, the man is going to die, but yet they are doing this because so far the bill is 15 lakhs. This is the extent of corporatization of medical. Is it not the duty of the government to provide medical aid to the public of this country because we are collecting tax? Why the public is not questioning the government? We are supposed to spend 5% of GDP, but we are spending only 1.1% of GDP. This is never discussed in the parliament. Why are we not questioning the government? Once we do this, once we improve the expenditure on health, whatever millennium development, we can lead the world and show that we can do better than you all. But we don't do it. Ensuring equality, quality of education. I have already told the quality of education we have. We have RTE 2009 right to education. But funding allotment is getting less and less after the enactment of this act. Hanumantaya told in 1960 that 6% of the GDP should be spent on education. We are spending only 2%, 1.8 or 1.87. Why are we not increasing? We have privatized education. Education also has become a dhanda. Everyone is selling degrees, everyone is getting a PhD by paying 10 lakhs for 20 lakhs. That's how we are doing. The best way to destroy a country is to give a substandard education system which we are having. This is going to destroy our country. We as a citizen need to wake up and try to work on it, but nobody talks about it. Education is you people, I don't know why you people are keeping quiet about it. Nobody is bothered. Once you do this, you can lead the world. You can show to the world that we are here, we can do, we are come to lead the world. No, but it cannot. Water and sanitation. Last 5-10 minutes, I'm sorry. Water and sanitation. We have told we have given water and sanitation to everyone. But you know this water is an example whether we have given water and sanitation to everyone. That's a clear indicator. For this also, 0.8 lakh crore is required per year to achieve the target of millennium. So for this, to eradicate poor, we need only 9.15 lakh crore to eradicate millennium poor in another 9 years. If you allocate 9.9 lakh crore, this entire poverty will disappear. Then come the second category, is the improving the quality of life and gender equality. Here also, give 50% reservation in the parliament and job, it will take care. There's no need to invest anything in this. But we would like to do in a corporate way. Then for further sustenance, MSME, we are telling we have to go on for MSME, we have to go on for resilient structure, for PPP models. PPP models is another big fraud on the core of this country. 80% of the investment is from the bank, 20% is from the company, and that 20% collects all the toll from the road tax. We are not bothered, nobody questions this because it's a Western model, capitalist model. We need to question and abolish this, but nobody does it. Karnataka has done it. So this is for the second category to improve the quality, we need roughly 15.9 lakh crore per year. 15.9 lakh crore. The last one is about environment, clean energy. Clean energy, I will show the hollowness of it. We have committed for clean energy and we have committed for 44% non-fossil fuel energy. At the same time, when it comes to the tariff fixation of wind and solar power, we have fixed it far below the fossil energy. How are you going to achieve it? It's complete. How are you going to encourage non-conventional energy when you fix the tariff lower than fossil fuel? Time has come for us to question this. Similarly, electrical EV policy, electric electrical vehicle policy. You would have read day for yesterday's statement of the transport minister. He says we don't have electric vehicle policy. We are not contemplating. We have committed to the international community we are going to do this. But at the same time, here we say we can't do that. We need only 2.6 lakh crore to give power electricity everything to people. Germany is doing free electricity to entire citizens. People will laugh giving free to please check up from Germany, they are giving electricity free to everyone. Then smart city concept has come. I don't know what the smart city concept is. All smart city for capitalization, for capitalists and everything. Nothing is that. We are not good at town planning. We are messing up the towns again and again without realizing it's going to be a disaster in the days to come. Low carbon strategy, we have not spent a single penny, but we have committed to doing 6%. For this particular aspect, so category 1, to remove poverty, we need 9.15 lakhs. Category 2, we need 15.9 lakh crore per year. And category 3 on environment, we need 21 lakh crore. So roughly 45 lakh crore is required per year for across the country to do this. Now how to do this? Having told that, I will just conclude by telling how to do it. We can, even this three categories, the politician need to categorize how we are going to have an equitable distribution of things and work on it. Simple logic, the figures are staring at you, but you don't want to stare at it. And just avoid it. This is not the way we work. So look, have a look at this particular categories and equitably distribute the funds. Funds are available in this country, it's not that it's not available. Put the budget of India and budget of all the states put together, you can easily get revenue receipt and expenditure and whatever we are doing. We can easily adjust all these amounts. But where there's a will, there's a way, we don't have that. Increase the agriculture output by 17 to double the agriculture import. Let it be 34% of the GDP. The hunger and poverty will disappear. Nobody talks about it. You economists should talk about it. Why are you people also not talking about it? Keeping mum on these issues. Then another thing is utilize 6,000 million cubic meters of rain, out of which 4,000 million cubic meters go waste into the sea. And then we have drought and famine because our economic policy doesn't accommodate how to go about this, utilize this water. Utilize these water resources. You need not ask back from the World Bank or other countries for the money to comply with the Millennium Development Goals. 3 billion tons of coal we have, which is equal to $300 trillion. We have 1 trillion tons of iron ore, which is equivalent to $250 trillion. Look at the amount of money we are sitting on. And but yet we say, oh, we can't do anything. $500 trillion are with us. And 42 lakh crore is nothing in compared to this resources which we are having. But we never talk about it because nobody does it. Reduce the education of car loan is faster than education cost. That's the priority we give. Reduce education loan. Agriculture. Give marginal farmers at 1%, 2% interest. Why are they charging 12%, 30%? And give for bigger farmers, give more rent rate. It's fine. Reduce and then provide. Government should provide basic facilities and it should not be corporatized. You are paying tax, we should demand it. But that's how we can achieve the Millennium Development Goal of a sustainable Millennium Development Goal. Reduce corruption. For heaven's sake, you youngsters, please don't pay money for anything, including to your own brother or sister or your own children. Stop this activity of appeasing people and getting things done. Our country is in shambles because of this corruption. Nobody talks about it. I have worked for 36 years on corruption and I have addressed all the IAS officers for 7-8 badges continuously from 2013 to 2018. It doesn't have impact. The officer who I addressed was caught taking money in Tamil Nadu. We take everything casual. We take everything casual. Abolish corruption. Last but not the least, have you people heard the Indian Parliament discussing Sustainable Development Goal or Millennium Development Goal?
No.
Italy and Nigeria has brought it as a part of their budget. And that's a parliamentary committee to monitor this. Where are we? We are trying to find fault with Nehru for this, all the ills now. And we are trying to blame the entire world, telling that because of Nehru we are like this. This is how what's happening in our country. Time has come to wake up. Bring this Millennium Development or Sustainable Development Goal as a part of a parliamentary process. Let the Indian budget be on basis of SDG. The day you achieve SDG, India will be a superpower. But none of them are interested. You youngsters are here and historians and economists are there. Please think about what I have spoken. I will be giving a paper on this. And please flag it up and try to take it forward so that our country is developed. I am sure where there is a will, there is a way. And India is a great country with a great cultural capital of the world. Once it starts realizing it, it takes time to gain momentum. But once it gains momentum, no one on the earth can stop. And that moment has to be created by all of you here, including the students. Thank you for giving me.